And now, for your listening pleasure, the Blazing Defender Report with your host, Travis Jones.
What? My face is rounder.
From what?
From fucking holding water.
So, what is it called?
Bulking face.
Bulking face.
My bulking face.
So you got the bloats. Me and Ernie call it the bloats.
The bloats.
Yeah. When you're bulking, it's the bloats.
The bloats. I can see my cheeks and my eyesight.
Yeah, you can't. Yeah.
That's awesome.
That's fucking awesome. That is awesome.
Coming to you with my bulking face.
I like it. I like it. What's up, guys? Blazing Defender Report. I have a very, very special guest straight from the synagogue. This is no lie. Big Sam's in the house. Say hello, Sam.
What's up to all my Jewish friends out there, all my non-Jewish friends. Happy New Year to you. It's Rosh Hashanah. I'm not supposed to be working, so I figured I'd do a Blazing Defender Report.
Oh, Rosh Hashanah. And yeah. Technically, you don't get paid.
Right.
So it's not really like work.
Right, exactly. Yeah. That's kind of my point. I do want everyone to know that I snuck in 3 ostrich sticks in my pocket today to synagogue, because we were there for like 4 hours, you know, and you got to eat. So I lied to my grandmother and told her I had to go to the bathroom. I went and sat on a toilet and ate 3 ostrich sticks. It's 42 grams of protein.
Why did you have to lie to your grandmother about it?
Because I think if I told her I snuck food into the synagogue, like, that's not cool.
Oh, so it ain't like you can't eat.
No, next week we're not supposed to be able to eat. We're supposed to fast, which won't happen. But I did.
I was about to say, you can't be talking about bulking cheeks and then fasting the next week. Yeah, that just makes no sense.
I'm not fasting.
Yeah, let's not.
So I did. I snuck ostrich into the synagogue today.
Wow. That's cool, I guess.
Yeah, whatever. It's like the time I snuck fish into the movie theater. That was fucked up. Oh, Everyone was pissed.
Yeah, I'd have been pissed too. Yeah. I'd been like, what the fuck is this guy doing? Yeah, he's got bulking face. He's got to eat.
They're like, this guy. It was especially great when I pulled out the fork and knife out of my other pocket and started. It was hilarious.
Gross. All right. We're not here to talk about Jewish holidays. What is it again? Rosh Hashanah?
Rosh Hashanah. That's Jewish New Year.
Happy New Year.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank
happy Rosh Hashanah to all our Jewish fans.
Today starts anew.
Okay. That's cool. I did not know that. Right. See, we educate you here on this show.
We are diverse.
We are very diverse. And not only are we going to teach you about that kind of stuff, we're going to tell you what was really cool on the comic shows the last couple weeks. But before we get into that,
from a Jewish perspective,
from half of a Jewish perspective,
is this going to be the
pagan perspective, Jewish perspective?
Is this going to be the time when you reveal to me that I actually wasn't your first choice as like roving field reporter, but you needed to fit a certain demographic or percentage or something?
I don't know what you're talking about. We don't do that on this show.
Okay.
BDR Studios does not. We give the job to the best guy.
Just go for the best candidate.
Just the best candidate. Now, you did happen to check off a box in that diversity column.
Right.
Which always helps.
That's cool.
But, who do you think my first choice was?
I don't know.
Little Sam?
No. Good luck finding that guy.
Right. But first, before we get into all the comic books, we have a pretty cool story about a guy that we met the weekend before last, right?
Weekend
before last.
Like 10 days ago.
Cincinnati Comic Expo. Right, that what it was?
Yep.
The Comic Expo we went to. Very, very cool.
Oh, my God.
Huge. It was so much bigger than last year.
Man, last year was big. Like, I was like, this is a big con.
Yes.
And this was at least had to be double.
Had to have been.
At least.
And we went on Saturday, which is the biggest day. You went on Friday also, right?
No. We drove by it on Friday on our way to Jeff Ruby's.
Okay.
Ate well. But, and there was, tons of people out in front of the expo center and everything. So
Friday,
sure it was packed. Yeah.
I bet it was.
But yeah, Saturday was incredible.
Incredible. Tons of cosplayers.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of comic books.
Everyone was Deadpool.
Everybody was Joker.
Yeah, everyone was Joker, too. Joker and Deadpool.
Yeah, I thought I'd see a lot more Harleys.
Me, too.
And a lot more women that shouldn't be Harley. I thought I'd see. And there were definitely some of them, too.
Yeah.
I think every con's going to have some of them.
There was that one chick I got a picture with that was a weird something or other. I didn't know that had pink hair, but she was really fat. So I was like, man, I'm about to get a picture with this.
Yes. It was interesting. And me and your brother, like, we had to run off almost.
Yeah.
He took the picture.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah, you ain't getting me like that no more. Fat Mira and Black Aquaman
that was the greatest.
Was the last one.
That was the great. And the furry, the cat guy.
That one was fun. I'd do that one again. But the other
Fat
one.
Fat Mira wasn't fun?
No. Because I was literally laughing at her.
I just don't know how you can be married and you can't swim. You know?
Because you float. Like that. She fucked the dude. The Aquaman didn't have to swim. He could just hold on to her. He's not going to drown.
No, yeah, he's good,
dude.
Could you imagine, like, if someone attacked Atlantis and Fat Mira was there? She'd never catch him.
I'd just leave.
She's like, shit.
Like, if this is the queen of Atlantis, I'm just leaving because this place ain't worth having.
Yeah, she was kind of like the queen of Golden Corral. Like, it was kind of the same.
She's banned from Golden Corral. But while we were there, there's a lot of artists and stuff. Yeah. Some very, very cool ones.
So many talented people.
Oh, my God. Man. Oh, yeah. Guys, you don't even know.
Oh.
I'm going to show you a print from a guy that we bought, and we still didn't catch his name. It was Buzz something, right?
Oh, yeah, Buzz.
It's a very, very cool print. I had to have it. I'll show you what it is. But first, I want to tell you about he's probably the hottest young artist to come along in, the last 20 years?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. He's definitely, he's hot. He's hot right now, for
you,
sure.
You had a great comparison of what his art style is like.
Yeah, he's kind of a Jim Lee, Ivan Rice-ish. He's kind of in that, you know, that mold.
You put those two names together, and you got a hot artist.
Yeah, that is a good comparison. That is a big compliment.
Yes. Oh, yes. It's a huge compliment. But this is the print that I bought. His name's Jason Fabok.
Yeah, he just finished up a run on Justice League for the New 52.
And that's the print that I got. Dark Knight Returns fan, obviously. That's Batman on the horse. If you can read that, I'm trying to get it there in there. There it is.
To the man who knew too much, the Blazing Defender.
Jason Fabok.
Not the first time someone's ever said that about you.
Actually, it was the very first time. And he wouldn't have said it then if I hadn't have made him. But there's a reason. As we were talking to Jason, asking him what he's up on next, and he said he was going to finish out his run on Detective. Is that right?
No.
Justice League.
Well, right now he's not on anything. He's got the Justice League Suicide Squad
crossover
versus Suicide Squad event coming
in
December. It'll start.
Okay.
And then he said, I'm going dark for a year. He didn't say it like a douchebag. I don't want to think people think he's like, well, I'm going dark for the next year.
No, he really didn't know how to say it.
Yeah, he was trying to
find words.
Yeah, he was trying. He was cool, man. He was trying to tell us.
So cool.
Without telling us, you know, like he was like, man, guys, you are awesome. You know, I love the Blazing Defender, Meatheads on movies, you know. He's like, but I can't tell you this, man. I have to sign too many confidentiality.
He did a non-disclosure agreement.
He did, yeah. He was.
And I said, hey, man, it's cool. So you're doing the Watchmen crossover when they break into the DC universe. Yeah. And he didn't know what to say, did he?
He looked down and scratched his head.
He went, I mean, you couldn't be any more busted than he was.
I turned to you and said, I think you got him.
I think I got him.
And I do think you got him.
I think I got him on that. We'll see. We'll see if Fabok's on it when the Watchmen come to the DC Universe, because we know they're coming.
He won't be now.
He won't be now because I just blew it.
Now it's
Jason didn't do it. We still don't lose.
Yeah, if anyone from DC is watching this, which would be awesome.
Give me the credit of blowing it just so I can get the hate mail.
Yeah,
seriously,
Jason Fabok did not tell us anything.
Did not. Like, totally inferring all this.
Yeah, he tried his very best to not give away anything.
But, Mike, is it Steve Ditko? That's the Spider-Man artist. Who's the guy that runs DC?
Oh, Dan Didio.
If y'all have a poker game, a weekly poker game where Fabok's in, I went in because you can take that guy's money. It's no poker face.
No poker
at all. He kind of stumbled around. I think we might have got him on that. But so when I went back to him about the print, I said, to the man who knew too much, Blazing Defender, and he he was laughing the whole time he was writing it down.
He loved it.
He loved it. So, and trust me, we loved interacting with him, talking to him.
Such a good guy.
Such a great guy, and a fucking fantastic artist.
And there was never anyone in his line. I was like, man, there's what, 10,000 plus people at this con
at least,
and none of you all know who Jason Fabok is? Like, you guys are idiots, man.
Just look at it. If you could just walk by and looked at his prints, because we did that to a lot of guys.
Yeah.
And we're like, holy shit, look at that. That's amazing.
When all his prints were straight out of the Justice League books.
Pretty much. And the variant covers that he's done. Yeah. I mean, that was a variant.
Yeah.
But, like we walked by this guy.
Yeah. Buzz.
Look at that. Look at the detail in that. That is just epic badass.
His
right
Dark
there.
Returns print was awesome.
It was awesome. I should have gotten it as well. I don't know why I didn't. But he signed it. He's like, oh, I'll sign it for you. I'm like, oh, great guy. I don't know who you are.
Yeah.
But sure, please sign it. So, but I had his card. It's justbuzz.com.
Yeah, check him out.
Check him out.
He's on Facebook on Buzz Artist.
Is he?
Yeah, Buzz Artist.
I mean, he's got all kinds of shit like this. I mean, this was like $10. Are you kidding me? Come on. Now Jason's was 20, but he is Jason Fabok.
It wasn't fucking Neil Adams prices, though. $40 a print. Come on.
We try to keep the show positive, we also like to keep it real.
Yeah.
Neil Adams is a dickhead.
Yeah, he's a super douchebag.
He's a super douchebag. What more can you say about that guy?
Nothing. Fuck him.
Fuck him.
Fuck him.
Yeah, fuck him.
His wife asked me to keep it moving last year, and I was like, why would I want to be here any longer?
Right.
You know, like,
well, you were going to kick his ass, it sounds like.
There was a chance. Like, I wasn't at that point yet, but there was a chance I would have had to fuck him up back into, like, 1970.
Yeah.
Like, when he was decent.
Yeah, well, yeah.
I'm taking you back to the time when you were okay.
Now, I have to admit, some of his stuff looks amazing. I'm not going to lie.
Like old stuff?
I don't know. He's got a Walking Dead print of Rick Grimes shooting the brains out of a zombie.
Yeah.
And it's fucking amazing. If I hadn't known all that about Neil Adams, I would have already bought it because I love it. Every time I go buy this thing, I'm like looking for it.
$40 for it?
I'm not paying $40 for it. You don't have to fucking sign it. No, is this print just $40?
$40.
Fuck that guy.
Yeah, it's an additional $30 to sign it, so you need $70.
And you can't even, like, walk by him and take a picture.
No.
They want to charge you.
Yeah.
If you're just walking by and you snap a fucking photo, they want to charge you.
Yeah, they try to come through and, like, Men in Black you with the little thing.
Now,
you don't remember Neil Adams.
Right. The guy did an homage to himself.
Yes, he did.
For covers, classic covers that he created for Marvel. He did an homage to himself, which he basically did the same cover.
Yeah.
That he was homaging. Is homaging a word?
Yeah. Well, today.
Fuck, it is on this show anyway.
Right.
But that's just kind of a dickhead that Neil Adams is. Yeah, so, Jason Fabok is not Neil Adams. No. So
he's better.
Oh, yeah.
As a human being. And as an
way
artist.
Better as a human being. And as an artist.
I saw Neil Adams. What was that book the other day? Coming of Superman or something where there's like four or five Superman?
Yeah.
He did the cover for it?
Yeah.
Fucking sucked, man. The cover was awful.
He hasn't done like you said, his recent stuff, he hasn't done anything that I've been like, holy shit, that's Neil Adams.
Yeah.
Some of his older stuff is very, very nice.
When I saw him at the con, I was like, holy shit, it's Neil Adams. Fuck that guy.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. We say that every time we see him.
Every time.
Oh, and I'm not going to drop any names. But we have talked to several artists at the cons, and they hear us talking about Neil Adams, and they all make it a point to go, hey, were you guys talking about Neil Adams just now?
Yeah, we won't say his name.
No, we're not saying anything like, we're doing this. We're talking like, God, fuck that guy, he's a dick.
Right.
And people overhear us because we're big and loud, and they go, are y'all talking about Neil Adams? And we're like, yeah. And they're like, he's such an asshole.
Every time we tell a Neil Adams story, but if we leave it anonymous, someone else has a Neil Adams story.
Yes.
And none of them are good.
Sure sign you're a dickhead.
Right.
Sure sign you're a
dickhead. Well, what about when he said he basically created the characters you're seeing on Arrow right now? Like, you can't basically create something.
That's a good one.
You know? Like, what the fuck? You either did or you didn't. And you did it. Like, I feel like I'm going to go around basically, like, now I've basically created human life.
Right.
Just fuck it.
Right,
you know?
Yeah. I jack like, off all the time, right. So therefore, I'm creating something.
Yeah. My thing is, like, you know, if you could just basically create whatever the fuck you want, even though you had no hand in creating it, like, I'm not going to stop at a couple characters on TV and in comics. I fucking create everything.
So Fabok basically created Batman because he draws a really good Batman.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, that's total good logic.
Yeah. I'm doing it all. Yeah. I'm doing it all. I basically create everything.
Hey, if you like Neil Adams, like Neil Adams. We're not telling you not to like him. We're just saying, artists are great, but there's so many great artists, but then you can be cool on top of that.
Yeah.
You're good in my book, and I'm going to continue to buy your shit.
And that's what I was getting ready to say anyways about the con, really, was there were so many really cool and really talented artists whose names you've never heard of, who haven't worked on any major projects that could easily step into a DC or Marvel book, and their stuff would be fantastic.
Easily.
There's so many incredibly talented people.
Yeah, there really is.
So you don't have to be a douche on top of it.
You don't have to be a douche, ever. Have to be a fucking douche. No, I mean, and this is what gets me, and we have this discussion about Alan Moore all the time. These, you know, with Neil Adams, any of them, Fabok for that matter, who's just getting started, your fans make you.
Yeah.
DC's not going to pay you. Marvel's not going to pay you if you're not great and popular.
You got to sell the issue.
You got to sell the issue. And I'm sure when Neil Adams started, he might have always been a douchebag. I don't know if he was or not. But I know there's a lot of people that probably feel like Sam and I do. We still see Neil Adams stuff. We might go, oh, that's pretty cool. I'm moving on. You show me a Jason Fabok or an Alan Bellman.
Yeah, I was just going to say, Alan Bellman's 93 years old, and he's still cool.
Cool as hell, and will let you know the very first thing out of his mouth is, you guys are the reason I get out of bed in the morning.
He said, you guys keep me out of the rocking chair. That's exactly what he said to us.
93 years old. I mean, he's...
I used to work on a sketch.
Fucking gangster, that guy.
Yeah.
Fucking gangster. And he's seen it all. He's done it all. Worked side by side with actual legends.
Right.
Not Neil Adams of the comic world, but the Stan Lees, Jack Kirby's of the world.
Steve Ditko's.
Yeah. I mean, the dude is a legend. Still to this day, gives all the props to the fans.
Yeah.
Because it went for us... No one would give a shit. Alan Bellman was at a comic convention.
Right. Exactly.
So, just for all the artists out there that are doing stuff, just keep it real. Be cool to your fans. And the art's always going to sell itself. It's like I tell a good friend of ours, Chad Nuss, who's just getting into the industry. He's a fantastic artist, a great storyteller. He's got his own comic book called The Silence.
Silence is so good.
Go to thesilence.com, check it out. But he's a very, very interesting individual. He's a super polite, super intelligent guy. Have people get to know you. The art's going to sell itself. But have people get to know you, and you're going to make fans. Put you over the top. Yeah, because there's a bunch of good artists.
There is.
You need something to set yourself apart besides your art. All right. Comic-Con was great. If you ever get a chance, you should go. Even the local ones are great. That's where I met Chad at a very small comic convention called Comic Cavalcade here in Louisville, Kentucky.
That should
met
be coming him. Up again this
yeah,
year.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I don't know when the dates are. I'll ask Chad, because I'm sure he's going back to it.
Yeah.
But... Chad and I hit it off there, and we're still friends today. And when he's in San Diego Comic-Con, hopefully he'll take me with him. Yeah. All right, because that was the deal, Chad. Don't you forget. Okay, this show's about comic books. This is the stuff we love. Sam and I read some different things, and we read some of the same things, have some different opinions on them.
Yeah.
So I've been wanting to have Sam on so we could discuss some of it. Let's not start with that one. Let's start with another one.
Okay.
We're going to do the DC stuff first. And we're going to start with a writer that I've loved his run on Black Panther. I know Sam loved it too. A guy named Chris Priest. And we're talking about the Rebirth Deathstroke issue. We're in issue 3 right now. So it's kind of just gotten started. So it's not too late for you to get on board with
Although
that.
Although there's 4 issues that are out. Remember, there's the Rebirth one and then 1, 2, 3.
I've talked about it on this show before about how the Rebirths are numbered. Yeah. If they were 0.
Yeah, that's what I would make it 0.
It'd have been so much easier.
I think Batman's was 0.
I want to say one of them was.
I know the Rebirth one was 0.
Right. That's the one I thought maybe I was thinking West. Of.
which is like one of the greatest single issues ever written.
The only 10 I've ever given on this show was the Rebirth Zero, the Wally West issue that kind of sets
Johns.
Yeah, that kind of sets up this whole DC Universe Rebirth. That starts there, that issue. It is single-handedly one of the best single issues I've ever read.
Yeah,
all the Rebirth stuff has been pretty good, I think.
That's what I was going to say. Well, I think Justice League sucks.
Justice League sucks.
It sucks.
Yeah, and that's a shame because it was so good.
And I've heard, although I haven't read it, I've heard Cyborg is really bad.
I have not read
it. But I think those are the only two that aren't good or better.
Okay.
I was going to say before we got started, I wanted to say that, you know, for those of you who are on the fence with DC, you know, maybe you got put off by some of the new 52 stuff or whatever. Rebirth is firing on all cylinders. Yeah. I mean, it's...
Rebirth is everything 52 should have been.
Yeah.
And now they're kind of recrafting the story to tell you why the new 52 sucks so bad.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
If you think about what they're doing, and just for full disclosure, there has been an event in the DC Universe. They had stolen time. Someone has stolen time. Correct me whenever I'm wrong, because this shit gets me confused all the time. Has stolen time from the DC Universe. They're thinking 10 years. 10 years was taken from everyone. Okay? There is, we think, I don't know if this was ever really officially said, that this story that DC Rebirth is telling, containing all the titles in the DC Universe, is telling the story of how and why these 10 years were taken.
Mm-hmm.
Am I right so far?
Yeah, as far as I get it.
As far as I get it, too. Okay. Now, with that being said, that means you should technically be reading every DC title to get the story. We're hoping that's not the case.
It's kind of felt like the case a little bit.
It has kind of felt like the case a little bit. Because I know there's some things happening in other stories that I'm not reading where it is alluding to. Now, this may be a spoiler for some of you, but for those of you that are on the fence about getting into the DC Universe, this may sell you a little bit. Because I know I was pretty hyped when it kind of dropped that these individuals were partially responsible for the 10 years. The Watchmen. Alan Moore.
Dickhead.
Alan Moore's classic Watchmen, I know it's a fan favorite of a lot of people. They or someone in that group is responsible for taking the 10 years out of the DC Universe. Why? How? We don't know any of that yet, but they're dropping seeds. Jeff Johns is dropping seeds in all these issues. As far as how and the why.
We saw a little bit in that Rebirth Zero.
Yes.
I don't want to say who. Detective Comics just had someone in the cloak and hood. Again, I don't want to say who. You have to infer who it is, but I think it's a pretty good inference.
Yes.
Ted Kord, who I think is the Night Owl in Watchmen, is now... The Blue Beetle is also named Ted Kord, so we're wondering about that. And
that's pretty cool.
The coolest to me of all the rumors is that in Justice League, in the New 52, they were going to reveal the Joker's origin. And everyone, including myself, was like, man, I just don't know if I want a Joker origin. You know, half the reason he works is because, you know, he's multiple choice, man. You
right,
know?
Right.
And then the reveal was that there's three Jokers. And I was like, I might be able to get on board with that if done right. That's cool.
Yes.
And one of the big rumors is that the comedian, you know, is one of the Jokers.
Which you could totally see.
You could totally see that.
Yeah.
And that would be cool.
Which, with you saying that, I think we can go ahead and say at the very end, when Batman finds
the pin,
the comedian button that was, it might have been on issue one.
Yeah.
The cover of issue one of The Watchmen. There's a smiley face with a bullet hole with blood running down. That was kind
of
like the comedian's signature. Yeah. So you could, if you know the comedian, you can totally see that parallel, crossing finally. But very, very cool stuff. But you still have to have single issues that work for your title.
Right. And so, I think they have for the most part. But you can tell.
There's a bigger story to be told.
You can tell there's a little bit missing.
And
you get more.
That's been the magic of Rebirth to
me.
Is they're still telling great single issue stories. Fantastic for the characters. But there's these seeds of something bigger looming in the background that Jason Fabok is probably going to be drawing. So I cannot wait for that.
It's almost a giant event
It's going to be a huge event.
But an event that's actually good. You know, because I personally hate event comics for the most part.
For the most part, yeah.
They work here and there, but for the most part, I feel like they fail.
I do too.
But this feels like the coolest event that could maybe have ever been done.
Yeah.
If they pull it off so far, it's been awesome.
It's been very, very, very cool. And we know with DC and the multiverse and everything, it's believable, I guess, if you will. But getting back to the single issues, Chris Priest on Deathstroke. I love Chris Priest. I love Deathstroke. I thought this was a marriage made in heaven. So far, I've really, really liked it. Now, in this particular issue, it's Deathstroke has found out that someone has put a hit on his daughter, the Ravager. And Deathstroke and Wintergreen go to get her. There is obviously some tension between Ravager and Deathstroke. Your dad's, you know, one of the greatest assassins in the DC universe. There's going to be some problems. But she's also like an anti-hitman.
Yeah.
It's revealed in this book. So they have a little bit of tension, how he finds her with her boyfriend, but she says they're not sleeping together and all that. I really liked that dialogue between the two.
Yeah. Is there also some sexual tension between her and Wintergreen a little bit? Because it kind of feels that way.
I didn't get that. I feel like it's a Bruce Wayne, Alfred Pennyworth, Robin relationship. Whereas Wintergreen was probably more of a confidant and a mentor and a father figure to her than Slade ever was.
Okay.
Because even Slade says, what did he say about making her weak? Like,
relationships make you weak.
Yeah, make you weak. Well, he said several things that make you weak. Like, he talks a lot of shit to her.
He's
a huge dick.
Tough love. Tough love.
Very, 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 very tough. But if you've been reading this book, and I think it's one of the negatives that you had about it, it jumps back and forth a lot.
Man, a ton.
Especially in the first
three
issues. Yeah. Even though this is issue three, it's actually the fourth issue in the story. There's a lot of jumping back and forth.
Yeah, this one's more linear, and thus was my favorite issue of the four.
Mine too. I don't mind the jumping back and forth, because I think they, for the most part, they've made it work. Sometimes I got to go back and read it again.
Yeah, that's my thing. None of it's been bad at all. And I love Chris Priest and the way he builds worlds.
He builds worlds.
You know.
And Deathstroke needed that.
Yeah. I just don't know, you know, with all the back and forth, you got to read it a couple times. A great comic book you read a couple times because you want to and you were blown away by it. An okay to good comic book you have to reread because you're not quite getting it.
Right.
You know, so that for me was a little bit of a knock.
I agree.
Now, when you reread it, it works. But I'm kind of like, it's a little convoluted to me. I also think the artist, who's a great artist,
so
a lot of the characters to me look too similar.
Bennett?
Yeah. And so it's hard for me sometimes to distinguish when we're jumping back and forth, who's what, where, you know.
Joe Bennett was the pencils.
So I think if the characters looked a little bit more distinguishable,
it might make
that a little bit of an easier transition.
Yeah.
But this issue, like we said, is more linear. It's more in the present, and thus it was the best issue of the four.
So but I will say, in us saying that, and now just flipping through it, I remember this now, Ravager is a precog. Okay, so in the beginning,
she has that moment with the other hitman,
and you're
like, I didn't know what that was.
I didn't know what that was either. Yeah. I'm like, and this is what I said, fuck me, I like to read this motherfucker again because I've been missed something. And I went back, I didn't have to reread it because
she reveals it like 2-3 pages
exactly.
Later.
And you see, I like that.
I think
that's a fantastic plot device, if you will, to get you engaged, to get you going, what the fuck? And then 2 pages later, you're like, oh. She's a precog. That's pretty cool because she's seen that shit coming. Yeah. You know,
well, it was her saying, okay, if I make this move, then this outcome's going to happen.
Yes.
Which was not favorable. So she went a different path.
Right.
With the situation.
Right.
It was cool.
Very, 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 very cool.
It was cool.
This would be, for somebody that's just getting into it, I think this is the issue that would sell you on getting the other three, actually.
I
like this issue a lot. Now, since we're on that subject of getting kind of confused and what the fuck is going on.
You gonna jump?
I'm gonna jump. All I'm gonna right. jump. It's my show. We fucking do what we want.
We're gonna
go from DC. We're gonna quantum leap. Yeah, that's a good quantum one. That's a good leap. Yeah, remember that show?
Yeah, man. Did you ever make it home?
No.
Fuck that.
I think the very last episode left it open to interpretation.
I hate that shit.
I hate that fucking shit. Yeah. God damn it, tell me.
Right, sure.
If I'm gonna just infer shit on my own, then I won't watch. I don't have to watch it. I just come up with a good episode in my head.
Exactly.
It's gonna have more sex, more violence in it. You know what I mean?
Big titties.
It's the credits. It's gonna be on titties.
I'm gonna go, damn man, he just jumped into a world of titties.
Be a great show. Captain America. There's my camera there. Captain America. Steve Rogers, Captain America, number 5. Okay, the one that the story that people were dousing it on fire and lighting it up and going nuts because you made Cap a bad guy.
But thank you, because that issue one value has gone through the roof.
4 printings, I want to say.
Yeah, and that first printing, people was burning it up.
Burning it up.
Thank you.
I mean, if you like, I would have done. I would have bought one, put it in a board in plastic, and then burnt one for the video. But I'm keeping that motherfucker just in case. All right,
thank you.
But Nick Spencer, not my favorite writer. He's done some okay things. Some things he's done has sucked. But I figured, okay, I'm gonna give him a shot on telling the story.
The Fix.
Is that Nick Spencer? Shut up.
Yeah. That's Nick Spencer. Spencer Lieber.
I thought that was Lamar for some reason.
Nope. Nick Spencer.
Wow. Okay. Well, I take all that back because The Fix is fucking fantastic.
Yeah. Nick Spencer is really, really good at one certain style of writing.
The Fix. Whatever style you want to call it.
And he did Superior Foes of Spider-Man. Which was the same exact style as The Fix. It was incredible. You would sit down and be texting me like, dude, this is fucking amazing.
I've got that on my list to read. Yeah, because of The Fix. I enjoyed The Fix so much, which it's on its fifth printing. Which is fucking insane.
Yeah.
And how that's not a movie or a TV show yet, I have no idea.
It should be.
It's going to be. Yeah, there's no way that's not going to be.
And see, mine was the opposite. I read all of those Foes of Spider-Man, the Superior Foes of Spider-Man. Mm-hmm. So when they announced this, The Fix, with the same creative team, and I read the little synopsis, Crooked Cop, yeah. I was like, oh, he's going to nail that.
Man, you was right. Yeah. He did.
But he's good at that one specific style, that sarcastic, the guy's kind of a fast-talking, he's kind of like, he writes like Vince Vaughn talks or something, you know? And he's great at that.
They're kind of like, in the beginning, you think they're bumbling crooks.
Right.
Like crooks that not very good at what they do.
Right.
And then there's a then
reveal.
6 pages later, they're officers.
Yeah.
Holy shit. And they're investigating their crimes that they're doing themselves, right, which makes it even more fantastic. It's a great book.
Yeah. He's been doing the Ant-Man, and he's great for Scott Lang, too.
Yeah, that would
Scott
be.
Scott Lang's that fast-talking, sarcastic,
reluctant hero.
Yeah, kind of the guy that he's kind of a piece of shit. He's got some good stuff in there, too, though. But you love him.
Right.
And that's kind of the guys on The Fix.
Yeah.
That's how the Superior Foes guys were.
And that's Scott Lang. With hashing this out, this really, it doesn't bode well for this, then, to me.
I was surprised he got the reins of Captain America.
Yeah, especially this story that they're trying to tell.
Right, but I was interested.
Yeah, well, I still am.
Yeah.
But for those of you who don't know, a little girl, the Cosmic Cube became a little girl. Don't ask. If you don't know, don't ask.
Kobik.
She warped, or changed, I should say, Cap's reality.
Yeah.
He grew up totally different than the Captain America we know. So, in the reality that she created, he was raised basically a Hydra sleeper agent. Yeah. So, everything that Cap is doing now is to basically reform Hydra and make Hydra great again. Mm-hmm. And in doing that, this coincides. Marvel's real good about continuity.
Yeah.
For the most part. And they have a big event going on right now called Civil War II, where there's an Inhuman that can predict future events.
Ulysses.
Well, Ulysses. Now, this has really thrown a monkey wrench into Captain America's plans because he doesn't want this kid to catch wind of what they're doing.
Because everyone still thinks Captain America is the actual just Captain America.
Oh, yeah. He's totally, you
know,
covert.
The agent of S.H.I.E.L.D., you know, and all that
right.
stuff.
Right. No one knows this.
Right.
Because the only reality she warped was Cap's.
Right.
So no one else knows. He's still Cap. He's still doing shit in the shadows, but he's taking orders from the Red Skull.
Even though he hates the Red Skull.
Even though his real plan is to kill the Red Skull.
Which is funny how even in either reality,
he still wants to kill the Red Skull. Yeah. Because he doesn't like the ideas that Red Skull has for Hydra. He has a different view because his reality's been warped. His mother was killed by a Hydra agent who basically took him in, Steve Rogers in as a young child. You get into a lot of that here. There's a lot of flashback that shows you. But when we were talking about jumping back and forth, some events that have happened in the main Civil War II book, they play out here. And one of the big events of Civil War II was, spoiler alert, if you don't know, the Hulk is killed. Mm-hmm. Hawkeye kills the Hulk. It's not what you think. Well, maybe it is what you think. And it kind of is what you think, actually. But there's reasons behind it. I won't get into that here. But it looks like, and it's not definitive to me, that Captain America had a part to play in that. He's trying to misdirect Ulysses from him getting a vision of what he's got planned for Hydra.
Well, it kind of came across to me in the chapter that Cap really is almost the cause of this entire Civil War, too. You know, like...
Well, he didn't have anything to do with Ulysses,
though. No, Ulysses came and he did the thing, so there was always that tension, but he pushed the tension.
Yeah, that's what he's doing.
And has caused all the events since then.
Right, right.
Which has caused the Civil War, you know.
Right. Well, yeah. I mean, Captain Marvel and Tony were still at odds because how they wanted to use Ulysses.
Right, right. But there was a chance for them to maybe still sit down and talk.
Sure, sure,
you know,
sure,
and all
sure.
that. And he's pushed that war.
Okay, now that's...
It's how they came across to me.
If you haven't read the issue, we're probably going to confuse the fuck out of you. Because I'm confused myself. He has Eric Selvig in his possession, so to speak.
I didn't know Selvig was bad. I mean, I know he is in this book, but I didn't know that this.
Yeah, I was on the assumption that his reality was warped as well.
Maybe it was.
Yeah, but you're right. That hasn't came out.
Yeah.
And I don't even know why I assumed that.
Yeah.
Because Red Skull had him. He was in Hydra's care, he had an occupation with Hydra. Red Skull sent Cap to kill Selvig because he was a loose end.
Right.
Cap, having his ulterior motives against Red Skull, made it look like he killed Selvig, but kept Selvig in his possession for what he has planned, which we really don't know why yet, because Cap really hasn't divulged that in the book. So now this Ulysses thing's come up. He takes it to Selvig, and Selvig's like, holy shit, the list changes everything. We've got a seesaw operations, everything. He's like, no, I've got a plan to take Ulysses out of the equation. What do you know about gamma radiation? Is what he asked him. And Selvig's like, Selvig sends something to Bruce Banner about a cure for the Hulk, which... I'm confused because I thought Amadeus Cho had already done that for Banner.
Me too.
Okay. Here I was bragging about Marvel's continuity, and I don't know if this is part of that. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know either.
So, but whatever Banner got or whatever he received on a jump drive, he plugs it in, all you see in the panels him going, like, what the fuck is this? Now, was it bullshit? And whatever he put in that drive, that's what triggered Ulysses' vision that brought S.H.I.E.L.D. on top of Banner.
Banner, right.
I don't know. Okay, so let's say that that's what Cap was talking about. The whole thing that happened in the last issue of Civil War II, we're actually reviewing three or four books in this one review.
It's so tied in.
It's so tied in. It really is. And but see, this is my point. This is what we were saying a minute ago. A book needs to stand on its own.
Yep.
And I shouldn't have to read, oh Lord, all of these tie-ins to understand what's going on in this issue. That's right. Bullshit. Because,
right.
Say, I'm not buying all those. I'm a Captain America fan. This is the only book I'm buying. You need, if you're going to put Civil War II in, it's in the cover here even. Civil War II, so it's a legit tie-in. You still had to make it, and it's hard to do, don't get me wrong. But we're guys that read comic books all the time, so if it's confusing for us, I can only imagine what it's for a new reader.
Right.
And that's what sucks.
But I will say that I do only read Captain America. I don't read Civil War.
Okay, and I'm reading both. Yeah, well, you read Kingpin, though, too.
Yeah, I'll read a couple of titles that are tied in, you know, as far as tie-ins and such, but the main Civil War, I haven't touched one sentence of it.
Yeah, I have. I've liked it.
Yeah, but and I've been able to follow it for the most part.
Sure.
But, you know, I had to kind of know that the Hulk had got killed.
Right.
And kind of know that Matt Murdock defended Hawkeye.
Right.
You know.
Right. But, you know, this book is a little bit more than a tie-in because, like you said, it's looking like Captain America has really fueled these events.
Yeah.
Now you've got this woman, the kind of straw that broke the camel's back between the two sides, and we probably should say the sides. Tony Stark is saying that you can't use Ulysses because there's no way to predict the future.
Right.
Captain Danvers is saying, yes, you can. If I can stop a crime happening before it happens, it's Minority Report.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Civil War II is Minority
Report. It's Minority Report. So what do you do? But now Cap has manipulated events, and there's a woman that... Carol Danvers, Ulysses sees this woman doing something to destroy the financial institutions of America.
In the name of Hydra.
In the name of Hydra. Yeah, she's a Hydra agent. She's doing this. It's in this briefcase. Carol arrests her. The chick's tripping out. She has nothing to do with Hydra. The briefcase was empty.
Right.
Which brings Selvig to say, he can't be wrong.
Right.
Now, did Cap have something to do with her? Where did all that come from?
Yeah, and maybe he did, but I don't think so, because if you remember, it pissed Cap off, because he said, okay, that's good, but her mentioning Hydra at all is a big issue for me.
That's true. He did say that.
So,
yeah, so maybe he didn't.
Know, right, so I don't know.
Yeah, but, so I would assume then with him saying that he didn't have anything to do with
it. But we don't know. We don't know how deep Cap goes. Maybe he's playing Selvig, too.
I don't know why he got that, how Ulysses got that vision then. It had to come from somewhere. Now, we haven't seen this yet. I'm sure it's coming in the next two Civil War issues that have been delayed till fucking next year, it seems like.
They added another issue.
They did. They added another issue, and they... It's been delayed three times.
Yeah.
The issue that has been delayed three times. So I want to say it's in January or February now that this is going to wrap up, which really sucks, but that's a topic for a whole other show.
I hope they don't do like they did with Secret War, where the other titles came out before, because that shit was confusing.
It was confusing, but I'll tell you what worked for Secret Wars that won't work for this. Secret Wars was widely accepted. And them adding the issue, even though it was late as it was, people loved it.
Oh, it was a great issue.
Great issue. It was like, I think IGN gave it like a 9.8.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a great issue. It wasn't that good.
For Secret War, a little bit was that it wiped everything clean.
Wiped everything clean.
Which just won't.
No. And that's another thing that we're going to get into the specifics of this issue. Not like we haven't, but Eric Selvig says, there's a kid that can predict the future. You got to get rid of him. You try to kill Jack Flagg. Jack Flagg ain't dead. He's one loose end that you've left out there.
Yep.
And Cap's like, he's a child. Even though he's a Hydra agent, Cap still has a code about him, it seems like. He's a child. And Selvig's like, dude,
I don't care.
So then you see these panels of Cap being in the room when Tony Stark comes in. The kid's sleeping. And I'm like, fucking Cap gonna kill a kid in his sleep?
Yeah.
You know, so I get it, his reality's warped, but Cap is a classic character. He's not like Wolverine. Not saying Wolverine's not classic. Jesus Christ, don't get me wrong there. Yeah. But what I'm saying is, an enemy of the state, Wolverine fucking killed a lot of people. A lot of people. He was mind controlled. I get it. So's Bucky. Bucky's done a bunch of shit and being mind controlled. There's a little bit of forgiveness there. Cap is iconic for morality reasons.
Right.
So you compromise that. You compromise the core of the character. And we're not erased. Like you said, this shit ain't getting erased. It's going to be canon. So I think they need to be real careful what they do here with Cap. Which, us going back to Spencer, maybe not the best guy for this, for this title, for this book. But I will say, it has kept me, this book has kept me interested, and it has kept me invested. It's an issue five, and I still get it every week.
Yeah, here's where I go with it is, it's completely different than any Captain America story we've ever had.
Sure.
And I think that's important because Cap's one of those characters I think is somewhat hard to write in the sense that he's been around for 75 years. How many more stories of a do-gooder can you tell?
Right.
You know what I mean? Brubaker broke the mold when he made his book an espionage book. And it's the best Captain America run of all time.
Winter Soldier.
Yeah, well, the Winter Soldier, the whole Brubaker run.
The whole Brubaker run. After,
yeah. With the trial of Captain America, the death of Captain America, and all that stuff.
Made me a Cap fan.
Yeah. It's,
like,
it's,
I always liked him, but he that run made him my favorite.
Yeah. And so far, this is nowhere on that level. Don't get me wrong. But I've enjoyed it.
We're not comparing
it. Right. But it is at least completely different than anything we've ever seen. And that's what Brubaker did.
Agreed.
Totally. So I'm interested in that aspect of it.
And it ain't played out yet.
No, and it's been good enough that I've liked it. I've enjoyed the issues. The artist, Jesus Saez, is the main artist. Is one of my favorites in the game. Now, this fill-in artist, Javier Pena, typically fills in for Jesus Saez, and does a pretty decent job, but I thought his art slipped a lot in this issue.
It looks unfinished.
Yeah.
A lot of it looks unfinished.
The flashback scenes look really good, and the modern stuff, I think, looks unfinished.
Yep.
So the art slipped a little on this issue, but that won't stay true.
We need this is a spoiler too, but this one of the reasons this also was the ending of the last Civil War II, and I'm just going to show it for the iTunes listeners. I apologize, but as you can see, that is Spider-Man Miles Morales and Cap, and it looks like Miles did him in.
Right.
Now, at the end of Civil War II, the newest issue, they keep Ulysses out of the fight. There's a huge fight between the sides. These tendrils come off Ulysses and go to where everybody's battling. Everybody stops in the middle of the battle because they're all seeing Ulysses' vision. Not only does he see it, he feels it. So, which makes it a little bit different than just like reading the future. He actually feels these things instead of just seeing them. And everybody kind of stops what they're doing. Spider-Man stops. Cap stops. Everybody stops. Like, holy shit, what are we looking at? And it's Miles standing over Cap's body looking like he killed him. So, did Miles find out what Cap was doing? Did they fight? You know what I mean? Right. And who knows? But what this was Cap's fear that somehow Ulysses was going to get a vision of him. Does this have something to do with him being a Hydra agent? Who knows? But... again, keeping us interested.
Stay tuned.
Stay tuned. Yes. Stay tuned, true believers. Okay. Enough of that book. A book I want to make sure we get to. Seven to Eternity, number one. And that's a... there's a glare on that. But that is... what's Opinia's?
Jerome
Opinia. He's the artist on this book. Rick Remender, the writer. I love Rick Remender. I know he's hit or miss for a lot of people, but I have loved a lot of his stuff lately.
He's pretty much always a hit for me.
Yeah. I know some of the stuff he's done.
I didn't like his Cap run with Romita Jr.
No.
It sucked.
Yeah, there you go. But
pretty much
everything else. Well, like you said, Cap's hard to write, too.
Yeah.
And Remender does good writing. I don't want to say non-superhero stuff because I like his Avengers stuff.
Him and Uncanny X-Force. That's one of the greatest runs of all time.
Yeah, that was pretty good. But it's not superhero stuff. That's more like Assassin.
Yeah.
I mean, I get what you're saying. Yeah. I mean, it's still superhero stuff. But
it is more.
Cap's hard to write. Yeah.
Cap is hard to write.
But he hits, for me, he's hit way more often than not. He's one of my favorites.
Yeah.
The stuff that he does hit on is fantastic. Tokyo Ghost is one of my favorite titles of the year, you know, a little bit of last year and the beginning of this year, how they finished it up.
Deadly Class is phenomenal.
Yeah, I've got it. Black, I got it here too.
Black Science is phenomenal.
I don't read Black Science.
Yeah, I think you'd love it.
I'm sure I would.
Low was very good. Now he's got the Seven to Eternity.
Low, I've read the first few issues of Low's. Yeah. Okay.
Low took a while.
Shit.
Is that Ghost fucking Rodgers?
Motherfucking Rodgers.
We're talking about Steve Rodgers.
Steve Rodgers. Mr. Rodgers. Go back to sleep, yeah, Mr. Rodgers.
Go back to your kid's bed or whatever.
You're right. But Opina's art is worth the price.
He was with him on Uncanny X-Force.
Yes.
And on Fear Agent, which was one of Remender's first big hits.
It's okay. Image I didn't know that.
And the art duties flip-flop back and forth between Opeña and Tony Moore from
Walking Dead. Oh, okay, Tony Moore.
And
it's
I read the whole thing. It's like 40 issues or something. It's fantastic.
Okay, I'll have to check that out.
Yeah,
7 to Eternity is really, if you want something different out of your comic books instead of a lot of the mainstream stuff. I know I catch some shit because I read a lot of mainstream stuff. It's what I grew up loving. It's what I love to read. But I love the new shit, too. Image is really killing it on a lot of fronts.
Independent guy.
Yeah, right. I call this my indie corner, usually. I get shit. You don't read any indie books. I read all kinds of indie books. If Image books are indie books, then I read a lot of them. But this 70 Turn is the very first issue. It's kind of like a Western sci-fi with a superhero element, I think, or let's say a superpowered.
Supernatural, superpowered.
Yeah, that guy, the old man in the beginning, he could have some kind of...
he taps into something.
He taps into something. And the villain definitely is tapping into some dark shit. If I could show this real quick, splash page. Of Opina. This is not doing it.
That's the God of Whispers, the Mud King.
The Mud King. I mean, that's a splash page. Just the art's just beautiful.
Well, when that old man tapped in and stuff, I couldn't tell if those were old ghosts or souls or something. Right. That's kind of why I said supernatural, too.
Right, right.
It's super something.
It's super something, but
it was super good.
He's kind of like the Mud King, who's the main villain that you get to see at the very last page of this. He's got three horsemen, basically.
Kind
of,
right? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So they kind of do his dirty work, and they're coming after this family. One of the guys kind of sacrifices himself, it looks like, so the others can get away. Some of them don't, some of them do. The one that does, I don't know, he kind of goes back to the Mud King
to save
the rest of the family.
Maybe.
Yeah, we don't know what the deal is.
Right, that's the end of issue one.
The Mud King is wanting you to hear an offer. And he promised his father, the one that sacrificed himself, you don't ever hear the Mud King's offer. So, it's like I said, it's very interesting.
Well, that's what I think is cool about it. It's such a different type of villain in the sense that the Mud King doesn't come through and obliterate people or anything like that. Yeah. What he does, he gives you an offer. It's kind of like the devil. He gives you an offer, and if you accept his offer, which I don't think anyone turns it down once they hear it.
Right. That's what his father told
him. He's inside your head, and now he can manipulate, control whatever you do.
So I wonder if this Mud King is some kind of psychic or what do they call him? Like Xavier, an empath.
Yeah.
To where he can make you take the deal, or whether he really is offering you a deal and you just end up taking it because he's pitting you against your worst self. You
know? Yeah, and we don't know. For me, the way I was going into it was more of a be careful what you wish for. He finds your weakest point, and that's what he plays and offers to you.
Yes.
And probably gives you what he says he's going to, but you don't realize the price that it's now come with.
Right.
Which I just think is so interesting and different.
Oh, yeah. Different. Yeah. For me, with Opina's art, the story can be so-so. And I'm going to love the book.
Yeah.
Because the action that he draws, especially when the guys are fighting with their abilities, it's just fucking phenomenal, man.
Opina's one of the best in the game.
One of the best in the game. One of the best in the game.
He's an artist I will pick a book up for his name.
Just for his name. Yeah. Absolutely. Well, and Remender, too.
Yeah,
Remender, too. So now you put both of them. You got the perfect storm. Right. I'm buying the book.
I just want to warn people that Remender, the way he kind of writes, his first issue or two throws you right in. So you're going to be a little confused. We are. everybody is, that's just how he is. And then he will explain to you starting issue 3, 4, 5-ish. Mm-hmm. So, yes, so if you pick it up, and you're like, man, I enjoy this, but I don't know what the hell is going on. That's how it's supposed to be.
Just give it time.
Yeah, just stick with
it. But a lot, unlike a lot of people that try to do that and fail, you don't enjoy that ride.
Right.
You're like, what the fuck is going on? I'm not enjoying this.
Right.
You're going to enjoy this ride. And one of the things is they always put Remender with a fantastic artist.
Yeah.
So it's win-win. You know, you're going to be like, what's going on? Goddamn, that's cool looking.
Yeah.
And then 3 issues in, you're going to go, oh. Now, the next book we're going to review, Remender really didn't start that way. Like, this is atypical for Remender how he started. And the reason I definitely want to talk about this book is we're on issue 22, Deadly Class. That's Saya. Mm-hmm. She's an Asian assassin in high school, mind you. He told me about Deadly Class. He's been reading it from Jump.
Issue 1.
I did not. I've been wanting to read. I had some time. I'm like, you know, I'm going to check out this Deadly Class. I bought some trades at a con we were at. Read book 1, and I was like, holy shit, this is fucking fantastic. Now, stay with me. It's like, what did I compare it to? Pretty Little Liars, which I don't, if you don't watch that, it's about some hot girls that go to school, and there's murder, death, mayhem, betrayal, all that shit. If you took Pretty Little Liars and put them in an assassin school, to learn how to be an assassin. A lot of these kids that go to this school, they're kids from very influential crime families, crime syndicates. But every once in a while, you get a kid that's, he's not a legacy.
Right, they bring in orphans.
They bring in orphans that are eventually called rats.
Rats. Yep.
Which I'm not spoiling any of that because when I read that issue, I was like, what the fuck is going on? Finals in this school is a bitch, let me tell you. But this is, I'm not even going to get into this issue. I want you to read this from the very first issue. If you like Walking Dead, if you like stuff like that, you're going to love this because nobody is safe.
Yeah, Game of Thrones style.
Very Game of Thrones, very Walking Dead-ish, very, if anybody read it, Avengers Academy was basically Murder World with a bunch of young Avengers, young X-Men that they all had to murder each other to get off. It was kind of like Hunger Games in a way. Mm-hmm. No one was safe. You didn't know who was going to die what issue. You think someone is the main character here and you're going to get a different one because that person is no longer around.
It flip-flopped several times. It flip-flopped a couple times just in that issue.
Yes.
Just in issue 22.
Yes. Issue 22 is kind of the new class.
That's what's amazing is you have 1, 2, 3, you know, 4 holdover characters, but for the most part, it's a brand new group of kids.
And you like them.
Yeah, immediately.
Immediately. Yeah. You like them.
Or at least are invested in them.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Some of them you were kind of like, oh, this douchebag.
Well, okay, specifically this issue, there's a Scotsman or an Irish kid.
Yeah.
And he writes him like he's like a Guy Ritchie movie.
Yeah.
Okay? So he's talking like that. And I like that shit anyway. I think it's funny. I think it's pretty cool. And I'm like, oh, I'm going to like this kid.
Yeah.
Well, I liked him for this issue. Yeah. Now, we don't know. He might come back.
Yeah.
He doesn't get expelled like a lot of kids get expelled. But how the girl, the redneck, how she manipulated those events. And I thought she was a dumbass.
Right.
She's not.
Yeah, I thought she was a dumb hoe.
Yeah, everybody. You know? Well, the first 20 issues, she was.
Yeah.
She was giving people clap and shit.
Yeah.
Because she was giving guys a clap.
Yeah.
But, yeah. I mean, I'm telling you, there's sex, a lot of violence.
And if you're a fan of the 80s, this all takes place in the 80s, so there's a lot of huge 80s references to music and the shirts they wear and stuff like that.
There is. And the color scheme is, I don't know, Miami Vice-ish, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
There's a lot of pinks and hues. It's not Stranger Things, but you definitely get the look of the 80s in this book.
You get the 80s feel.
I don't think there's a
there. I mean, that's
Victor. I mean, Victor's fucking Victor. Fantastic. I mean, see how everything's pink? Man, they're at a party there. But see, even, you know, I turned several pages. You see the hue? They're at a, basically, a mixer, like a,
yeah,
a
freshman.
Inviting the freshmen. Yeah, exactly. Welcoming the freshmen in. And there's some key players from the last school, the last freshman that made it past finals. They're kind of the new upperclassmen. Some of the upperclassmen are dealing with what they had to do to become upperclassmen. So you've got a lot of going on here.
One question I have is, are there no juniors and seniors? It seemed like there was only freshmen and sophomores, and the sophomores were running the school.
Yeah, that's kind of how it is, I guess.
So I don't know if maybe your junior year you're giving off to missions or something, like you're going off to actually doing assassin shit or something.
I don't know.
I bet Remender gets into that.
I'm sure he does, but you know, what's his name? Master Lin?
Yeah.
The guy that runs the school, he kind of walks over to that table of his upperclassmen, the new upperclassmen, is like, calls them his star pupils.
Right.
So it kind of told me that they were the varsity. They were the seniors.
So where are juniors and seniors at?
I guess you got freshmen, and then you got
sophomores.
You got, that's it. You go from freshman to senior, basically.
Maybe it's like an associate's degree.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know.
I got my AA associates in assassination.
Dude, it's so cool. Every character is so cool. You get very invested. And then when they're ripped from you violently, you're angry, and you're like, fuck.
The deaths are almost like, because it's a comic book, you almost don't believe it. Like, you know, like if you saw Cap die that way, you're like, all right, well, he's going to be back in a couple of
years.
They're
not killing Cap like that.
Right.
Right.
They do in this.
They do. I texted him several times when I was reading it, and I was like, what the fuck? No way. And you're like, don't get attached to nobody.
I said, don't do it.
And like Victor, who's obviously going to play a bigger part being upperclassman in this issue, the last 20 issues, he's just this huge douchebag.
Yeah.
He's still a huge douchebag.
He's kind of the dumb jock type.
Yes. But this issue, he's fucking hilarious.
Yeah.
And you love him.
Yeah.
And you're going to love it when he gets killed, too. Yep. And you're going to be sad because you're like, well, shit, there goes my humor. But Remender will introduce somebody else. Right. And I'm sure there's, you know, he's done this trick once with, you know, bringing in the freshmen. He won't do that again. It's going to go somewhere else.
And I don't know how they're doing it, but Deadly Class is going to be a TV show. Did you read that?
Fuck no, but that needs to happen.
Let me drop this on you. Guess who's producing it? The Russo brothers.
Shut the fuck up.
Yep, it's right here in the back. Let's see here.
See, I read that online. I didn't read it. I didn't read the comic.
Oh, it's in here. I'm filling in for Rick this time around because he's off writing the pilot for Deadly Class TV show. If you haven't heard, we're developing a TV show with Sony and Joe and Anthony Russo.
Sickness is what that'll fucking be. And for those who don't know, the Russo brothers did all the Captain America movies.
Not the first one.
Oh, that's right. They didn't do the first one. Two and three. The good ones.
Yep. I like the first
one. I did too, but it did not compare to two and three.
I'll give you that.
And they're doing the Infinity Wars with the
Avengers stuff.
So, yeah, that's a fantastic combo.
I think they want it to be on HBO.
It's going to have to be.
There's no way this could be on like ABC, you know? So
I wouldn't watch it.
But if this happens and it's with the Russo brothers and it's on one of those, you know, premium channels where you can cuss and kill and all that stuff. It's going to be amazing.
It's going to be amazing.
Yeah.
If they just stay to the core content.
Yeah.
And it's going to be fucking amazing.
And let me just say real quick, Wes Craig's art, he's done the art on all 22 issues.
He's fantastic.
Is incredible. It's so kinetic. The movement in it and everything like that. The one thing I like about Remender is he hates to have fill-in artists. He did before, like I said, on Fear Agent with Tony Moore and Jerome O'Pena,
who are two of his best friends. That's when he's getting
started, though. Yeah. But that was when he was starting. So what he does now is he'll drop an arc, you know, 6 issues, whatever it happens to be in that arc, that he'll take a 3-month break. And that's in order to allow the same artist to catch up and do their thing so he can keep the same artist continuous throughout each issue.
That's fantastic.
And I would rather that happen.
And I'll show you, there's Craig's art right there. And you can see, like, that. I mean, that's through the whole book. And you can see, like, she's all tatted up, but he, you know, hey, uses the negative space because she's very pale in the book. You know, she's got a sword. She's one of the most.
She's like a geisha, like those really white Japanese.
Yes. Yeah. And, like, everybody in the school's scared of her. Like, they were scared of her when she was a freshman. So she's pretty badass.
Yeah, we can't say why they're super scared of her now.
No, we can't
say that.
She's dealing with it though. It's fucking her up is what it is. And I think that's going to be the plot device that moves the next arc around because she's not going to be down. I think she's going to burn school down. She's going to do something. The school's going to change forever because of something that she does.
I agree.
All right. Speaking of properties, a movie. TV show properties. This is something that must happen. I never thought I'd like a book like this, but I fucking love it.
I had to hard sell you on this one at first.
Did you hard sell me on this?
A little bit.
Okay.
A little bit.
I like Scotty Young.
Yeah.
But it's, well, I'll just, fuck, you just got to talk about it. Fuck Fairyland. There's Gertrude.
Starring Gertrude.
There's my girl Gertrude. 30 something year old woman in a 12-year-old body or 8-year-old body. You set the premise for Fairyland, and then we'll talk about the issue.
All right, Gertrude, essentially, you want me to start issue one? Like, say,
yeah, just,
okay, the
yeah,
synopsis
just,
of it, essentially, yeah. Gertrude wishes upon a star that she wants to go visit her magical place of Fairyland, which, you know, where all her dolls and all this stuff are alive and things like that. And it happens, and you see her, you know, start to descend down this thing, and you're like, oh, this looks like a nice, pretty, happy story. And all of a sudden, she falls flat on her face, her teeth bust out, blood's everywhere, her arm's broken and stuff. And you're like, what the fuck is going on? So Fairyland is such a happy and nice and wonderful place at the beginning, and Gertrude is trying to find the key so she can eventually go home after
visiting.
That's
her quest.
Yeah. And she cannot fucking find this key for anything in the world. And Gertrude, essentially, although she doesn't age physically, inside, she continues to age, and now she's like 35 years old or something. She's still in her same like 7, 6, 8-year-old body, whatever it is. Right. And she is the most evil of all bitches. She doesn't give a fuck about anybody except her. And actually, she really doesn't give a fuck about herself either.
No, she really don't. No, she.
And this is just kind of the story of her
trying to find the key.
Yeah, adventures through Fairyland, which also has a pretty dark underbelly, we found out in the second arc.
And, yes.
I mean, there's cussing, there's blood, there's guts.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
There's drinking.
There's drugs.
There's drugs. I'm trying to find a good splash page.
Yeah, Scotty Young is he's so incredible, man.
And the reason I say this needs, this could be a fantastic cartoon Cartoon Network. Here's kind of a pretty good splash page.
Yeah, this is an Adult Swim show.
This is Adult Swim for sure. In this issue, Gertrude is in a poker game and she loses to a pretty bad dude. He's some type of wizard. He's got a lot of power. Gertrude didn't have enough to pay the table, to pay the bill. So she says she has something. I forget what it is. It's some type
it's
of
an
animal.
Animal, yeah.
We end up finding out at the end. It's kind of like, it's not a penophile, but it's something like that.
Yeah.
It's spelled real weird. So she has this, he's kind of like a Jiminy Cricket character, and his name is Bert.
Yeah. No.
No. What is his fucking name?
I don't fucking remember.
God damn it. He's hilarious.
Yeah, he is. He's probably my favorite character.
Yeah, and he's really, really good in this. Shit, I can't think of his name now. Anyway, he has this hat. It's a magical hat. And he can always, like, pull shit out of it.
Or put anything into it.
So, Bert's kind of like, I don't know where that thing is. You got a lot of shit down there over the last 30 years. So, Gertrude's like, I'll be right back. And she jumps into the hat, which I didn't know you could do that. So we get a good look inside the hat now, and it's just it looks probably like an Amazon fulfillment center. It's just huge. It's got shit everywhere. So she's looking for this penophile or whatever the fuck it's called, this animal to give this guy so he won't kill her. Gertrude's pretty tough, but this guy's pretty badass too. Not as bad as Gertrude, evidently. But so now she's in this hat, and they're lints.
Yeah, dust mite.
Dust mite things. Yeah. And that's kind of what's in the right there on the cover. that she's running from. And these things are everywhere. They're little monsters, and they're killing people that she had captured over the years and put in the hat and forgot about. They're like, oh, get us out. And, you know, the lints are eating them. So she has to team up with the people that she's captured to fight the lints off. And just craziness ensues. And it's like Sam said, it's blood and guts and violence. And there's even kind of like an homage to the old Alien movies. But the whole time, the little Jiminy Cricket guy that's Gertrude's companion.
The show.
Oh, yeah, it is. Oh, that's where the first guy gets killed.
Yeah.
Oh, let me see here. Here we go. Yeah, like she's like, he's trying to tell her to run. And then there's, she's holding the half of his body as it's, you know, there's blood on the floor and the lints are coming after her. So, this wizard, the little cricket dude is trying to stall for Gertrude to come. So, Larry's like this little
Samsonite. Boy, I was way off.
You were way off. Well, fuck, I was pretty way off too. So Larry ends up playing cards with these guys and getting them smashed and drunk. And there's a scene where everybody's laid out. Looks like some people had sex and everything. Yeah. Well, Gertrude ends up finding, or actually the penophile, no, it's a Castrophon?
Yeah, I think penophile is some weird shit. Like, I don't think that's good. That's actually not. That's
a ghost.
Yeah, that's not in this book at all.
No, it's not. Penophile's not in this book at all. But this Castrophon is like this little cat with antlers, and it's a badass. It's like, fuck, like this wizard dude thought they were extinct, but she has one.
Catastrophon.
That makes more sense. There you go. That sounds a lot cooler. So this Catastrophon, it's all cute and everything, and it just saved Gertrude's life. She's like, how you feel about really evil wizards? And the next thing you know, all this blood just gushes out of top of this place that they were playing cards at. So Gertrude again has saved her ass.
Survives.
She survives and to wreak havoc on Fairyland once more. So it's just it's different. Scotty Young's art's incredible. It's just a lot of fun, and I really like it. You know, these other books, do you really want to talk about them? They're not that good.
There's nothing really stand out about
it. I will talk about Thor real quick. I know you didn't read it, but because of what happens at the end of this, Jason Aaron is on the Mighty Thor. If you didn't know, you were under a rock somewhere. Thor is a woman now, and spoiler alert, it's Thor's ex-girlfriend, Jane Foster, who's battling cancer, but
Natalie Portman is Thor.
Yeah, that I would go see that, actually, because I love Natalie Portman. But so in this, there's a lot of stuff going on. I won't get into that because I want to talk about what happens at the end of this book. And the shield is on to Jane Foster as being Thor. They come to arrest her, and Jane Foster shows up. Thor is shot by a bullet that can actually hurt her, and she's in trouble. So Jane Foster shows up in front of the shield, and so they're like, whoa, wait a minute, that's not right. How the hell are you doing this? Thor, Jane Foster, doesn't even know what's going on. So Rosalind, who is the shield agent that is dating the Odin son now, she and Jane they know. She knows who she is, and she's even like, what the hell is this happening? At the very end, you find out that Jane Foster was Mjolnir, the hammer. And they didn't even know that Mjolnir could do this. So the question that Roz has asked her at the end is, does this mean Mjolnir is alive? Like, it's a sentient being. And the next issue is the untold origin of Mjolnir. So we get to find out. She goes to grab the hammer to ask it, basically. And there's thunder and lightning, and she's gone. So I'm sure we're going to find out what happens to her soon. Now, I will say Thor is one of my favorite characters. When I heard that Jane or that Jason Aaron was taking the hammer out of his hands and giving it to a woman, I thought, I'm with Jason Aaron. I love Jason Aaron. It has been a really good run. Not Aaron's best stuff, but it's been very, very good, especially at the beginning when she got the hammer. This part with her battling Roxxon and stuff is kind of drug on. So I'm glad. I think that's this story of Mjolnir. I think we're going to get back to the Odinson getting the hammer back. We know Thor has a movie coming out.
Well, he's got that miniseries too, the Unworthy Thor.
Right.
He's still going to have the axe.
Yeah, he is going to have the axe. When does that start?
Like November, December. But I was disappointed because it's only going to be a miniseries because it looks awesome.
Well, they're going to give him the hammer back.
He needs it.
So I think the miniseries is going to lead into the events that get their hammer back. Yeah. But that's what I mean is I think with this story being told is going to – we're going to transition Jane Foster out of the hammer and Thor back because we know he's got a movie coming back. We know the movie always generates new readers, new kids that want to – read Thor comic books, and they're going to go and be like, this is not Thor, Daddy. Who is this?
Right.
So they're going to give the hammer back to him, which it's long overdue, in my opinion.
Yeah.
So, but that's a very good book. Some of the other books were just kind of uneventful. I kind of like to hit the high points for people that have kind of got their toe in the water and really, they love the movies. They would like to read the comic books, but they really don't know what to read. They don't know what they'll like because people ask me what I read, and I read everything. So that's a bad question. And then I'll say, well, what do you like? And they'll go, I like Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Well, fucking good luck going to a comic shop and getting a Spider-Man book.
Because
there's 40 of them.
Yeah.
So you know, I kind of like to hit things that maybe superheroes isn't your thing. Well, then we've got Deadly Class. We've got Seven to Eternity. We've got it's out there is my point. And this is the best time in the fucking world to be a comic book fan.
Man.
You've got movies, you've got TV, and it all comes from this.
Well, and now Marvel's making their Marvel video game universe too.
What do you mean?
They're starting with I think it's a Spider-Man game that comes out maybe next year or something.
Huh?
Saw the trailer. It looks amazing. I don't even play video games.
Yeah, I do. I'm surprised I didn't hear about this.
Starting the Marvel, what they're calling the Marvel video game universe. It's going to be the same thing as the cinematic universe, but in video games.
Okay, so it's going to have continuity
and all the games are going to tie into each other.
So
that sounds pretty incredible.
Because I do play, Marvel Future Fight on the tablet. I love it. It's a lot of fun. And they have created new characters. For Captain America's 75th anniversary, they created a Sharon Carter Captain America, who's actually that, we call them Toons, those characters. That Toon is one of the most powerful in the game. And it's not in any comic book. But she looks phenomenal.
Yeah.
She's got like a diamond-shaped shield. She's got a lance. It sounds kind of stupid, actually, when I talk about saying it out loud. But she looks really good. So I wonder if is like for the Xbox or is it like
I think it's for console systems.
Consoles.
I think my brother's talking about it coming out on the PlayStation.
That's gonna be fucking badass. I'll be all in on that.
He was the one telling me about
it. Okay. I'll have to Google that and find out. See, I learned shit on this show.
It's the toys coming out, the statues. I mean, they're all incredible, man.
I'm gonna show the Batman first.
Yeah, you show the Batman things.
And it's heavy. Look at this thing. From Andy Kubert's Dark Knight 3 that he's doing now. This thing's heavy. It's this far out of my arm. It's like leverage is killing me. Look at the detail on that cape. So badass. Look how thick he is. I love it. How big his quads are. He's so badass. Love this. My very first statue, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
And then my second and third statues.
I just take them off the base.
Yeah. Artifacts. Captain America. Look at the detail on him. You can see inside his shield right there. Look at that shield. These are really nice. He's got metal pads on the bottom of his feet, and he comes with a little metal base right here, so you can stand him up.
Yeah, they're magnets.
And again, like I said, I'm a huge Thor fan.
This is the male Thor.
This is the real Thor, the Odin son. But check that out. Look at the camera. See if it'll focus in on his face. He's got that armor on his arm. Look at the cape, his hair, how his hair. He's got them luscious locks.
The Kylo Ren.
Got that Kylo Ren going on. But yeah, very, very cool stuff coming out. Artifact statues are reasonable.
Yeah, yeah.
For what they are. Check them out. I mean, it's the world is out there for anybody that's wanting to get into comic books.
You recently converted someone that I know. My buddy Luke.
Oh, yeah. You were telling me about that. Yeah.
My buddy Luke read comics as a kid, had been out of it for a long time, but still kind of liked the characters, watched the movies and stuff. And, you know, I was telling him, watch Meatheads on movies, man. Watch The Blazing Defender. And he did. And he came back. I was like, man, you know, I think I've been on the fence of reading comic books. And I think, you know, you guys convinced me to pick him up again. I brought him into a comic book shop last Wednesday. He bought about 6-7 books and then ordered on my recommendation the first two books of Jason Aaron's Thor run, the male Thor, the God Bomb and the God Butcher.
Two of my favorites of all time. Yeah. That you do not go wrong with that. That's funny you say that because Brian Cox, another friend of ours that never read comic books ever, he watched the show and asked me about what to read. And I said, I know you. You're going to love this. I gave him God Bomb, God Butcher, and he's a weekly guy now. He's got a pull list and everything. For you don't know what pull list is, you can go to your comic shop, be like, I want these titles every month they come out. They'll hold them for you. You don't even have to go every Wednesday. You can go whenever you want and get your books. But, yeah, so that's fantastic. I'm so glad. That's the whole reason I created this show. And there's two people, maybe more out there that are buying comic books.
It's probably like rape. Like if we heard of two, it's probably like really 20.
Yeah. Like rape.
It's kind of like rape.
I like that.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. I never thought you could compare rape to something and it'd be positive.
Yeah, but hey.
Hey, but it's a stat, right? So we're comparing statistics. The stat, not rape, like the act.
Yeah.
The statistic.
Right, the statistic.
Come on, guys. Come on. Yeah. We're better than that.
We do not condone rape.
No, we don't condone rape. But I'll tell you something we do condone.
Consensual sex.
Most of the time.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know what that is.
There's times you might regret
I'm married, so I have no idea what that is. But no, what we do condone.
Here it is, folks.
It's Loot Crate.
Loot Crate. You thought it was going to be at the beginning.
You thought it was going to be at the beginning. See, I waited to the end because I love you guys.
Right.
Loot Crate.
What is Loot Crate?
I'm glad you asked me what Loot Crate is. Loot Crate is if you're looking for gear, collectibles, houseware, and more of your favorite pop culture franchises, they got you covered.
Yes, they do.
Loot Crate offers a range of geek and gamer items for less than $20 a month. Want to bring your loot to the next level? Get a bigger box with even bigger loot with the Loot Crate DX.
Yeah.
I always thought it was the Mega Crate.
Yeah.
I think the Mega Crate's bigger than the DX Crate.
Yeah. Mm. What's DX stand for?
I don't know.
They should tell us.
It's just damn exciting.
Okay, damn exciting.
Without the E. It's a silent E.
Yeah.
Exciting. If you're more the type to wear your geeky heart on your sleeve, then Lootware, our monthly wearables and accessory subscription, is the droid you're looking for. Actually says that. That's funny. That chill running up your spine isn't your imagination. It's Loot Crate's October theme. Horror. Uh-oh. Stay with me now. I know that got some people shaking.
The Lootware thing, because that kind of sounded like some lingerie type shit to me. And then they just said the chill running up your spine is not your imagination. I think Loot Crate's trying to do something.
Yeah, you think there's like some little shit there trying to get you going one way.
Yeah, I do.
Ooh. Yeah. Well, I wonder what, like, because there is like an underwear subscription. There's a shirt, there's a sock, there's underwear, and you can bundle them and get a better deal on it.
Yeah,
So if it's a chick, because they ask you your gender, maybe they are getting like some sex.
Yeah, maybe it's like that edible Black Widow or something.
My mind went somewhere it shouldn't have.
Right.
All right.
Where it
horror is the theme.
Horror.
We're taking over 40 years of creepy, campy, bloody icons and putting them in this month's crate. Channel your best final girl with items from The Walking Dead, Nightmare on Elm Street, Friday the 13th, Texas Chainsaw Massacre, and Halloween. You have until the 19th of this month to subscribe and receive this month's crate. When the cutoff happens, that's it. It's over. But make sure you head to www.lootcrate.com/GiantSizeTeamUp and enter the code GiantSizeTeamUp and save some loot off your loot crate. Mm-hmm. New subscriptions only. I think it's new subscriptions only. I don't know. I haven't tried it yet. I don't know. I don't know if it's because I used to get loot crate.
Right.
I got some really cool stuff out of it, and then I started getting like Doctor Who shit and all some stuff that didn't speak to me. As big a geek as I am, I'm not that big of a geek to where I know all of it.
Got my Doctor Who house.
I got my Doctor Who, my Pikachu pencil sharpener. I don't know what the fuck. But there was some really cool stuff. I've gotten some really cool stuff out of it. I just, you know, I buy a lot of comic books each week so I can review on the show. So that eats up a lot of money. And now fucking jackass here has got me into fucking statues. Yeah. So there's more money. So I had to cut corners where I could. But Loot Crate's fantastic. And I'll be honest, total transparency here on this show. It really helps me out, helps us out, for people to sign up. Let me know what you think about it. Give me some feedback. Check me out on BlazingDefenderReport.com, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Tumblr. I have a fucking Tumblr page. Tumblr. Yeah, I post on it, but I'm never on it. But
not Grindr. Do not look not for
Grindr.
Us on Grindr.
Not Grindr.
We're not there.
What's the one you swipe left or right on? Tinder?
Tinder.
I'm on Tinder.
Tinder.
No,
check us
really
out
not.
On Tinder.
No, I'm really not on Tinder. No. Jesus Christ. Please don't start that.
Tinder a fake name.
It is. Yeah.
Willis Kaiju.
I'm the Blazing Defender. Can you imagine a single chick looking going, the Blazing Defender? What the fuck? Who's this weirdo?
I'm going to say yes.
Yeah, swipe right. Say yes. Is it right or left?
Fuck, I don't know. I think right is yes. It,
like, I'm taking yes. Okay.
Yeah,
so swipe right on Blazing. Swipe right on Blazing Defender. That'll be my tagline. But no, check me out. Love to have your feedback. Tell me what you thought about my boy Big Sam being on the Blazing Defender Report for the first time. Been really wanting to have him. Maybe we can buy a house down the street here and we can do it all the time. So check us out, Meatheads on Movies. We're going to be doing a Doctor Strange preview.
Well, we got to do Luke Cage next.
Luke Cage will be next. I've got to get off the fucking pot and watch some episodes.
It's pretty damn good.
Yeah, it's what you're yeah, like I haven't heard a lot about it.
And I will tell you, episode, I think it's 12, which is the penultimate episode, Method Man was in it and Stan Lee was in it. What more can you ask for?
Holy shit.
Wu-Tang Clan and Stan Lee.
Like, yeah, well, I've heard a lot about the soundtrack.
Yeah, soundtrack has been cool, but really to me the homage stuff is the coolest shit. At one point he's got the afro.
Neil Adams is making a...
No, no, and that's why it's good, because he's not in it. And he's got the headband and the big bands and the yellow shirt.
The tiara.
Yeah, and he's like, dude, I look ridiculous, you know. But there's so much cool homage stuff. One of the villains comes out in the full Sons of Serpent. I'm not saying they were Serpent Society.
Serpent Society, yeah.
Uniform and stuff, which I didn't think they were going to put that in there, and it's in there.
So good. That's good. They're still taking classic themes and making them work. Yeah,
in the modern kind of modern time.
Yeah, that's fucking hard to do. And do it well.
I watched 9 hours of it yesterday and finished it up. Nice. 4 hours Friday, 9 hours on Monday. Finished it. It's great.
Good deal. I'm definitely going to get some in this week. I'm hoping tomorrow I can knock a lot out. I'm at the firehouse tomorrow. I try to watch a lot of TV.
No one do no domestic violence shit. Get no car wrecks. No fires or nothing tomorrow. That way Travis can watch Luke Cage.
Please do that.
So, yeah, so everyone I can get be that safe. In. Keep it cool. Don't
yes,
beat nobody
always be
up.
Safe. Yeah. Times are crazy right now, so everybody's got to keep their head on a swivel. But we got that coming up. We'll have the Doctor Strange preview and review show coming up when Strange drops. Meatheads on Movies. Go to iTunes. This is something that I do, and I still hope people are watching. I know it's been a long episode. But for every 5 5-star reviews I get, your name will go in a hat, a random number generator, and I will buy you a $15 trade paperback of your choosing on Amazon just to get you started. So that's all you have to do. For every 5, there'll be a winner. 1 in 5. You got 1 in 5 shot. You don't think it's 5-star? Fucking lie. Give me 5 stars. You'll get shit. Okay? It really helps me out. Helps my numbers. Keeps me relevant. I know my schedule's been a little hectic lately. I know the show was really late in coming. I'm trying to get on a schedule where I can do one every week for you guys. So please tune in. Let me know your feedback. Let me know what you thought. And guys, with that, Blazing Defenders out. For Big Sam, he's going back to the synagogue, and he's going to finish his ostrich sticks that he stashed away under the pews. Y'all have pews in the synagogue?
No pews.
No pews? No. Okay.
No. I'm about to go hit this high-stakes game of dreidel. 10,000 to spin, motherfuckers.
Guys, thanks. See you later. Peace out.
Peace.